You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. This is the live garden show broadcast that is all about plants and plant materials and gardens. So I like to say we talk about everything from trees to turf and apples to zinnias. So if it grows in your garden or if you want to grow it in your garden, we will talk about it. And especially if you call in, because this is a live broadcast. And you can call us and ask any question about your garden you want. You can email us as well, and you can email us photographs about your gardens. I'm a plant pathologist, a certified arborist, and agricultural pest control advisor. I've worked in landscape maintenance and the technical issues about growing plants and maintaining plants for a long time. So give us a call or send us an email at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Today we're going to talk about insects. Last week we were talking about the role of fungi in the garden. Today we're going to talk about insects. You cannot exaggerate the importance of insect control in landscapes and the role that insects play in our lives. They are incredibly important, from biting us and transmitting important diseases, from eating our homes, eating our plants, and the beneficial aspects. We are dependent on insects to pollinate crops. So this just goes on and on and on about what insects do for us and against us. So we're going to talk about those today. But we like to start our show with upcoming events. Let's see what we have on our calendar for upcoming events so that you can get out and learn something about plant materials and gardening and enjoy our wonderful Southern California weather. Let's see what we have on our upcoming events. The Vegetable Gardening Workshop will be at Descanso Gardens on Tuesday, February 16th, from 10 to 11. This is a wonderful opportunity to learn more about vegetable gardening. If you haven't been into vegetable gardening in the past, you can learn how to get into it. Give them a call at 818-949-4290 for more information regarding the Vegetable Gardening Workshop. In addition to that, we have the Camellia Show and Sale at the Huntington on Saturday, February 14th, from 1 to 4:30. And I believe it probably goes again on the next day, Sunday, as well. What happens with these camellia shows is that the camellia growers in the camellia societies pick their flowers at home. They bring them in the morning on Saturday morning and display them on tables. And then about 1 o'clock, after they've all been judged and given their prizes, then the public is allowed to come in and see the flowers. You will see more camellia flowers and a variety that you didn't know exist if you go to any of the camellia shows. So give them a call at 626-405-2100 and you can get a good look at this camellia flower show. And they have them at Descanso as well. I think they have a couple at Descanso, so take a look at their website if you miss the one at the Huntington coming up on February 14th. In addition to that, we have the Mushroom Fair coming up at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on Sunday, February 14th. I think we have our dates confused there. But that's from 10 to 4:30, and this will give you an opportunity to see a diversity of mushrooms you will never see on your own hiking in the mountains. The mushroom, the Los Angeles Mycological Society, LAMS, will go out on Saturday, the day before the fair, to several locations collecting mushrooms all over Southern California. They bring them to the Arboretum, they set them up on tables for display, show you all the names, they'll have lectures on various aspects of mushrooms, wild mushrooms, how to grow mushrooms at home. So give them a call at 626-821-3222 for more information about the Mushroom Fair coming up. And we have one more outside event. The plant propagation class at the Fullerton Arboretum will be Thursday, February 11th from 9 to 12. This will almost certainly be a paid class. But if you're interested in growing your own plants, kind of from cuttings or from seed, or grafting, all the aspects that are involved in plant propagation. This would be a great class to attend. I imagine you'll be able to propagate some materials in the class and bring that home with you. So give them a call at 657-278-3407 if you're interested in attending that plant propagation class. So those are our upcoming events. If you are a student in the class, you do need to attend an outside event and write an essay showing what you learned about some aspect of gardening or plant materials. So if you go to a plant society meeting, a plant propagation class, whatever it is, then you can write an essay telling me what you learned. And don't forget, our phone number is 1-800-339-1193. If you've got a question about your garden, if you want to grow vegetables this in the next month, the planting time for your vegetable garden is coming up. Roughly March 15th is kind of the beginning of your summer vegetable garden planting season. I know a lot of people will start planting right now. They're planting in February. Things like tomatoes particularly. Get them an early start. If we have warm February, you'll get a jump on your growth, and you might be picking tomatoes by the end of May. And I've done that once, where I got my tomatoes in February and had ripe tomatoes before June, which is really quite remarkable. If you plant them in March, you'll get your tomatoes probably mid-June or certainly by July 1st, if they do well and you don't have any problems. But that's what we're going to talk about today. Insect problems, the good guys and the bad guys. Now, I have a variety of a couple things in here that are came into the lab during the week. If you've watched the show in the past, you know that I'm a plant pathologist and I have a plant diagnostic laboratory that I supervise for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office. That's my job during the week. I work for the county. And a homeowner brought this in during the week. I thought I would share this with you, because this is one of the ways you really learn about gardens and plant materials, is see what's coming in. And that's how I've learned over the last 40 years. Hate to admit that I've been working in gardens that long. But let's take a look at the overhead. The problem with this is suddenly his roses started growing some very odd foliage. It was dwarfed and small. And I'm going to pick off a leaf here. Now, I know it's dried up a little bit, but if I pick off a couple leaves, I can show you a good leaf and a bad leaf. Let's see here. This one is basically normal, this leaf here. But if you take a look at this one, you can see it's much, much smaller. The leaves were distorted and twisted. Now, I don't know of a pathogen per se that would do this. I mean, potentially, I guess powdery mildew might do it, but there's really no powdery mildew on it. So powdery mildew is not the cause. In fact, when you see this type of damage, and let me see if there's another leaf in here that kind of shows it. Actually, you can kind of see it on this twig here, this branch here. You can see that the growth, let's just move this a little to the side, the growth right here, this piece right here, is stunted and growing very poorly, and it's distorted and small, twisted. So what can, you know, this has to do with diagnosis. The other thing that the homeowner pointed out was the flowers themselves were, now these are old and kind of smashed up. They looked a lot better when he brought them in. But he says they're much, much smaller than they normally are. This is a floribunda, if you don't recognize the type of rose it is. But he says these flowers used to be about twice this size and now they're half the size. So that's an interesting set of facts. He did water it fairly frequently, three times a week, for about 10 minutes each time he watered it. So that's not a great way to water your roses. You want to deep water shrubs and trees, usually at the most once a week. He lived in Downey, so he's not in the hottest part of the Inland Valley, so he'd get pretty hot in August and September, certainly in Downey. So generally speaking, you know, roses, I'd water them, especially in the spring, about every 2 weeks, but a deep soak, I'd water them for an hour or two to get the water soaked to a depth of maybe 16 to 20 inches, because roses aren't going to be rooted much deeper than that depth. And so you want to soak the root zone, which is going to be maybe 20 inches deep, if your roses are doing really good. So, but anyway, so I suspected, you know, part of this might be how he's watering, but these symptoms really speak to either a virus or an herbicide. Viruses often cause distorted growth, twisted, distorted growth. and often a mosaic pattern. So you get this white swirling in the leaves, you get twisted leaves, small leaves, stunted new growth. But there's no virus known in roses that really causes that. The rose mosaic virus just causes a white color break in the leaf, and it's not all that bad for the plant. Many, many roses have rose mosaic virus infections. And you'll see that a few leaves on the bush will develop this mosaic pattern in the leaf, and that is rose mosaic virus. So I don't believe this is a virus. And so the only logical explanation was somehow these plants were exposed to an herbicide. He said that didn't happen, and you have to believe him, they're his roses. So it's still a little baffling as to what's exactly causing this damage. But this kind of highlights the diagnosis process that a plant pathologist would go through to try and determine what damage to the plant. About half the time when you get damaged plant materials, it's not an infectious disease. It's not a fungus or a bacteria or a virus. It is some type of cultural problem. It is the irrigation. It's the fertilization. It might be herbicide. It might be frost. It might be extreme heat, something of that nature. It could even be, on occasion, you'll see plants damaged by air pollutants. Usually they have to be close to a point source, sulfur dioxide damage. But even ozone damages plants. So on very smoggy days, ozone can damage plants. And that's why, actually, it's an interesting thing that I brought that up. That's one of the reasons all the vegetable growers moved out of LA County and now grow mostly in Ventura County, Santa Barbara County, because they have better air, and smog actually dramatically reduces yield for vegetable production. Maybe something you didn't stop to consider. So my best bet is somehow he got some kind of herbicide drift on these roses. The recipe for trying to fix it is to prune them back, because this is the time of year you prune your roses. Usually prune them down to about shin high, leave about 3 or 4 large canes, prune out the oldest canes that might have infections or cankers. It depends on the rose you're pruning. If you're pruning a climbing rose, you're not going to prune it that way. This is mostly for the typical roses people grow, the floribundas, the hybrid teas, things like that. But if he prunes it down and then does a thorough drench, you really want to deep, deep water them. If we get some good rains, and we had some good rain about a week ago, although now we're going into a week of warm weather, it's February and we're talking about 90s next week, or tomorrow and Monday, actually, today's Sunday. So, I just hate these hot days in the winter. I want cool, moist weather in the winter, sorry. But I know everyone loves the warm weather, but we need the rain and we need cool weather. It's fooling our plants, to tell you the truth. So anyway, if he deep waters them and leaches anything that might be in the root zone, gives them a little bit of fertilizer and see if they grow out of it. And they should. They should grow out of it. Anyway, that's the rose. It's not a definitive diagnosis, but that's what the symptoms are telling me, is this is probably herbicide drift. Now, I got some other things in here, and these are all samples that I want to share with you. And we're going to talk about a few of these things as insects. Now I want to differentiate between insects and mites. Mites are arachnids. They are not insects. They have 8 legs, and so they're related to ticks and spiders. Spiders, ticks, mites are not insects. They are arachnids. Insects have 6 legs, arachnids have 8 legs. It's an important distinction. So this is a camellia leaf. And if we go to the overhead, we can take a look at the damage on the camellia leaf. You can see that this leaf does not have very good color. We call this bronzing. This leaf has been fed on by the camellia mite. Now a healthy leaf will look like this. You see, it's dark green and shiny. A leaf that's heavily fed on will have this bronzing effect. Now, sometimes you can see on this leaf here, it's just right down the middle of the midrib, because that's where they're going to start feeding first, is right along the ribs or the veins of the leaf. Funny thing is, it doesn't really affect the underside of the leaf very much. It's just the same on both leaves. You can see that right there. But it causes this bronzing. It doesn't, it's not good for the plant, certainly. You don't want your whole plant to have this look to it. I would think it also diminishes or slows the growth and production of the plant. It's not going to kill it. This is something that's fairly easy to control, especially in the next month or so when your camellias or other plants that might be affected by similar mites. Now, a lot of these mites are very host specific, so the camellia mite doesn't go to anything but camellias. But when the new growth starts to come out in late February or March, you want to spray with something that'll control mites. Soaps and oils work quite well. And we'll talk about that more next week on materials. But I just wanted to share these two, that particular sample with you on camellia mite. And these others are samples I want to talk about when we get to those sections that we're going to get to here in a minute. Now, let's move on and talk about some books, because we're talking about insects. One of the best books you can have to identify insects in Southern California, at least the very common things you find every day. Obviously, you can find weird things occasionally that aren't going to be in this book. But this is Insects of the Los Angeles Basin by Hoag. Hoag was the curator of entomology at the Los Angeles County Museum, Natural History Museum in downtown, across the street from USC. So this is Insects of the Los Angeles Basin with this wonderful dragonfly on the cover. Just to open it up and, you know, there you go. Show you, but it'll show you, pictures of the insects. And then over here is a text describing the insects. They'll often show you the larval stage and the adult stage. So, and he does cover some insects and stuff. Here you can see butterflies and the caterpillars that are associated with those butterflies. He'll talk about some moths. Here again, this confuses me. Right here is one of the sphinx moth larvae or caterpillars. And this one, and I always get these reversed in my head, this is the tomato hornworm. There's also a tobacco hornworm and the tobacco hornworm moth. And let's see if they show the other one. Maybe it's on the preceding page. No, they only show the tomato with single stripes. But anyway, so this is Hoag's Insects of Los Angeles Basin. A little bigger book, and a little more expensive, obviously, is Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs, second edition, by Johnson and Lyon. Now, this is a really wonderful book, and most of you won't be interested in buying this, but you can actually go look at it at the Arboretum, because the Los Angeles County Arboretum has a horticultural library, and they've got this book. And if you're really interested, you can go through and look through it and read about various insects that feed on trees and shrubs in North America. And it's pretty extensive. So you've got sections on bark beetles and pines and all sorts of insects. Let's just flip it open and look at a couple pages. So here is root feeding beetles. You wouldn't believe how many insects there are. There's millions of them. Round-headed borers, these are all wood-boring insects. Flat-headed borers, explains everything. Shothole borer and other bark beetles, these are just happen to be bark beetles. Leaf mining maggots, it's going to show you the damage. It's going to show you the actual fly, the adult moths. And so it's talking about a variety of different species on this page. Boxwood leaf miner. So it shows you all these different insects. It shows the adult stage, the damage to the leaf, and then a long discussion, azalea leaf miners. We're going to talk about leaf miners in a minute. So there you go, Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs. And then I've got some other books that I'll show you here in a minute, but let's just move on. And now let's start talking about insects themselves, because we've been talking about books and everything else here. So insects. Insect is a class of arthropods. They have a chitinous ectoskeleton, a three-part body with a head, a thorax, and an abdomen, three pairs of jointed legs, which means six legs, compound eyes, and two antennae. That's what most insects will have. Now, there's some weird groups that are hard to place, I'll get into those in a minute. So insects are among the most diverse group of animals on the planet and include more than a million described species and represent more than half of all known living organisms. Insects are mostly solitary, but some insects, such as bees, ants, and termites, are social and live in large, organized colonies. Now, aphids are probably one of the most common insects that feed on plants, and they're really important for a variety of reasons. They are also known as plant lice, and in Britain they're called green flies. And they are very small plant-eating insects, and they are sucking insects. We are going to start with the sucking insects. Let me just say, from a gardening perspective, because you want to have this knowledge that leads to control. So there are two broad groups of insects, in a sense, those that suck on plants and those that chew on plants. So you have sucking insects and chewing insects. And it's important because they behave differently and your control strategies are going to be different. So aphids are probably one of the most common of the sucking insects. They've got a mouth part that is called a stylus. It's like a long, sharp tube. They poke it into the leaf and they start sucking the juice out of the plant and feeding on the plant juices. Now aphids feed on phloem. There are two types of vascular tissue in plants, phloem and xylem. Xylem conducts water. It is the wood in woody shrubs and trees. And it's scattered in herbaceous plants. It has a different arrangement in herbaceous plants like grasses and bulbs and things like that. So those aren't woody plants and shrubs. Aphids will poke into the phloem. Now phloem moves sugar. The leaves make sugars through photosynthesis. It is moved through the phloem to places the plant uses it, to the tips of buds, where the branch is getting longer and it's growing new leaves, to flowers, to fruit, and to root tips, because root tips are growing all the time too. So they need that sugar to grow, and the leaves make it. So the aphids land on the plant, poke into the phloem, and start feeding on the phloem, on the sugar, and it drips off their rear end, and when it drips out of them, it's called honeydew. And it drips on the lower leaves, and the leaves will become sticky, and they'll get a black mold growing on the surface of the leaf, and that's called sooty mold. If you see sooty mold on lower leaves in your plant material, whether it's a fruit tree or, maybe ivy even, or it doesn't really matter, you find this black growth on the leaf, and you wipe it with your finger and it comes right off and you just have this black smudge on your finger and underneath it's green. That's sooty mold. It's telling you you have a sucking insect infestation. So let's take a look at our first picture of aphids and bring this up full screen. And here are some aphids. This is the rose aphid. We can take a look at our next picture also of the rose aphid. And these are adults, but they haven't developed any wings yet. Now, they're fairly sedentary, and you can see there's a lot of them, and they can reproduce very quickly. They don't need males in order to reproduce. When they lay their eggs, they will not have even been mated, and so when they do mate, they will lay sexual eggs, but they can just reproduce by laying eggs, and they hatch, and they just, in 10 days, they're laying more eggs. And so it's very, very fast reproduction, astronomically fast. And you can go to just having a few aphids in 1 week, and then a few weeks later, you've got millions. So aphids are among the most destructive insect pests on cultivated plants. There are about 4,400 species within 10 families. Many aphid species are monophagous, that is, they feed on only one plant species. Others across many families. So there are aphids that will feed on almost anything. The green peach aphid feeds on hundreds of plant species. Aphids passively feed on sap or phloem vessels in plants, as do many of their fellow members of the Hemiptera. So aphids belong in what are called true bugs, the Hemiptera, and that includes scale insects and others. Plants contain low densities of nitrogen compounds needed for building proteins, and this requires aphids to consume an excess of sap to satisfy their requirement for nitrogen, and that's why it drips off their rear end. The excess is called honeydew. It drips off their rear end in large volumes that in some instances can actually look like it's raining in the tree. Now let's take a look at our next picture. Now this honeydew is really important because ants go and collect it. And you can see this picture here shows ants that are tending aphids, and they're going to collect the honeydew and return it to their colonies. Now I have a little video showing ants defending aphids. And a lot of things want to eat aphids, like ladybug beetles and others. Probably, you know, there's some predaceous mites, there are spiders, there's all sorts of things that will eat aphids. So ladybug beetles, of course, are famous for eating aphids, and they eat a lot of them. So you want to keep them around in your garden. So anyway, let's take a look at this video, our first video, that shows ants protecting their aphids from a ladybug beetle.
Lady beetles have a chemical defense. They secrete a substance that kills ants. But they can only produce a certain amount of this fluid, and the ants are many. The beetle remains motionless, trying not to call the attention of the ants. But if it is found by just one of them, it will alert the rest. This individual is the convergent lady beetle. Even with protection, a great number of aphids will be eaten by this insect. Lady beetles have been helping our agriculture since its beginning. The least thing we can do for them is to leave them alone wherever we find them.
So, that's a great video clip because it shows you a couple things. One is that there's this world occurring on the surface of plant leaves that we often are totally unaware of. There's a battle going on the surface of the leaf. It is a battle between the ants, the aphids, and predaceous insects that want to eat those aphids. And these ants are very, very attuned to protecting those aphids, and they disrupt biocontrol. So when you're trying to control aphids, you also need to control ants. The most common ant we have here in Southern California is the Argentine ant. It's not a native species. It was introduced from Argentina a long time ago. There's these little black ants. They come in your kitchen. They feed on sugars and protein. And so one of their main food sources is honeydew from sucking insects. And they will actually bring the aphids up in the spring and put them on the plant. And they will protect them when the ladybug beetles land and want to eat them. They will harass and push and knock that ladybug beetle off of the plant and protect those aphids. So you need to control them both. So that's a really good clip kind of demonstrating that. Now, so aphids, why are they really so important? There's a couple reasons. One, if their populations just explode and you can have your plant just covered with them, and they can cause distorted growth, and they could, you know, it's not good for the plant. It's not going to grow as well. It's not going to be thriving in your garden if it's covered with aphids. And if it's on your vegetable plants, you don't want them. They wash off pretty easily, but on some plant materials, they're hard to get off. On a leafy vegetable like, you know, lettuce or spinach, you can wash them off quite easily. But on things like broccoli, they're very hard to wash out of broccoli. So the other reason they're so important is they are the number one vector of viruses. Aphids will pick up a virus from an infected plant. When they grow their wings and fly off to another plant, they will then transmit that virus into the healthy plant. So aphids are the number one vector of viruses. So you want to keep them off, especially off your young vegetable plants, as much as possible, and try and prevent your young vegetable plants from getting virused. If they get virused from their little tiny plants, they're not likely to become big plants. Once they get to be big, if you're growing bell peppers or tomatoes, or if you're growing lettuce, once your plant gets up, it's got fruit on it, and then it gets virused, it's not going to affect your yield very much. So protecting your young plants is really critical, especially against aphids. Now let's take a look at our next group, which are called mealybugs. Let's bring up the long-tailed mealybug as our next picture. And you can see these long tails, and that's why it's called the long-tailed mealybug. And mealybug is a common name for a family of unarmored scale insects. This is actually a type of scale insect. They are found in moist, warm climates. And so that's the long-tailed. If we take a look at our next one, this is called the Taxus mealybug. They are sexually dimorphic, meaning that the sexes have different appearances. Mealybugs are in the order Hemiptera, which are the true insects that are sucking insects. They do not go complete metamorphosis in the true sense of the word. There are no clear larval, pupal, and adult stages, so the little ones just look like little adults. Mealybug females feed on plant sap, normally in roots or other crevices. So there are root mealybugs that you won't see that can do a lot of damage. They attach themselves to the plant and secrete a powdery wax layer all over themselves and all over the leaves often. And this is used for protection while they suck the plant juices. The males, on the other hand, are short-lived as they do not feed at all and only live to fertilize the females. The most serious pests are mealybugs that feed on citrus. Other species damage sugarcane, grapes, pineapple, coffee trees, cassava, ferns, cacti, gardenias, and orchids. Mealybugs only tend to be serious pests in the presence of ants because the ants protect them from predators and parasites. So let's take a look at the citrus mealybug as our next picture. And you can see even in this picture, you see ants that are tending the mealybugs. So if you want to control this, you have to control this. Now let's take a look at our next picture, and this is really important. If you take a look at this one, this looks like a mealybug. It is not a mealybug. This is actually the mealybug destroyer. And this is a larval stage of a beetle. And one of the big differences, how can you tell this apart from a true mealybug? And I'll tell you a story. I was looking at a gardenia one time, and I saw this particular insect, the mealybug destroyer, all over the plant. And they were walking around really fast. They're on the leaf and they're just cruising along. Mealybugs don't do that. Mealybugs are sedentary. They get into the crevices, they sit there and they're sucking on the plant juices. If you bug them, if you touch them a little twig or something, they'll get up and they'll start to move around, but they move very slowly. They are not fast moving insects. Predaceous insects tend to move much faster, and the mealybug destroyer is a predaceous insect. So it's moving around a lot. It's got to go find its prey. So I looked at all these things on the leaf and they're moving around really fast. Now at this particular time when I saw these, I wasn't familiar with this insect. So I brought it in and shared it with our entomologist in the department. And he said, oh, that's the mealybug destroyer. So leave them alone. They're beneficial. They're helping your plant. They're eating mealybugs or anything they bump into for that matter. And it's really important. If you see something that looks like a mealybug, but it's moving quickly, that's not a mealybug. It's almost certainly the mealybug destroyer. And this is the larval stage. It's going to pupate, and when it comes out, it's going to be the mealybug destroyer beetle that looks just like a ladybug beetle, except it's pure black. There's no red with black spots. It's pure black. Now let's take a look at our next scale insect. This is barnacle scale. And barnacle scale is a native scale that often occurs on native plants, things like ceanothus and toyon. I usually see it on toyon. And you can see all these coverings. Now, there are armored scales and soft scales. This is an armored scale. And here's the edge of the branch, and it secretes an integument or a layer, a coating, and the insect is here. This is protecting it from the environment. So if you spray these insects right here, these scale insects, this barnacle scale, you won't kill them if you're spraying them with something like an oil or a soap or a contact material, a pyrethrin. They won't kill the insects because they're protected from the environment. So scale are very, very hard to control without resorting to broad spectrum insecticides. So let's take a look at our next picture, which is the cycad scale. If you grow a Cycas revoluta or any of the cycads, you may get this. What you'll see on the tops of the leaves is yellow spots. If you flip over the leaf and look on the underside, you'll see all these scale insects. So if it gets this bad, if you have this heavy an infestation on something like Cycas revoluta, the sago palm, then you're probably going to need to spray with a broad spectrum insecticide, something like 7 or orthene, which I don't like orthene. It really is very stinky. I don't like it, but it's very effective. Or you may use a systemic. Now let's take a look at our next picture. This is the red date scale, and you can see the scale insects are here, and it gets in between the, you know, the leaves on the fronds. All this is kind of made by the insect, all this kind of frass-like material in here, and it does a lot of damage. It really does damage the fronds, and they look bad. Let's take a look at our next picture. This is cochineal scale on cactus. Now, cochineal scale has a really fascinating history. This, of course, is a beaver tail cactus or opuntia. It's also called prickly pear. And this is often what people call up and say, I've got this fungus growing on my cactus. Well, this is not a fungus. That is a scale. It's called cochineal scale. And if you smash this and crush it, it will be almost a burgundy red, almost a blood red. It was used to make dye for a long time. You would scrape it off the cactus pads, and then you could put it in hot water with your cloth, and it would dye the cloth red or pink, depending on how much you put in the water. Let's take a look at our next picture. And this is also cochineal scale. Now, if you allow it to get this bad, just covered with it, you know, all over the place, it's going to damage the epidermis. It's not going to kill the plant, but, you know, after you get rid of it and control it, you'll have damage to the plant and it won't look so good. So you do want to keep this off. You can wash it off with a strong stream of water. You could probably hit it with soap or oil or a combination of the two and get pretty good control. This should not be difficult to control, but you're going to have to come back and do it repeatedly. It's going to get on the pads when they're young and soft and probably avoid the older ones. Now our next group of insects we want to talk about are whiteflies. And they are small flies. They are in Hemiptera. They're not in Diptera, which are the true flies. There are more than 1,550 species of whitefly. The feeding damage can cause economic losses. And here you see the black-purple stage of a whitefly feeding on a leaf. There's the black stage. Here's a different stage, but these are whiteflies. Feeding damage can cause economic losses. It is the ability of whiteflies to transmit or spread viruses that has had the widest impact on global food production. So whiteflies is another good virus vector, particularly on lettuce. Feeding damage can cause losses. It is, that's just a repeat of the same thing I said. In 1997, tomato yellow leaf curl virus discovered in the USA and Florida, the plant disease is the worst viral disease of tomato and is transmitted by a whitefly, Bemisia argentifolii. So let's see if we have another picture of whitefly. Take a look at this next picture of whitefly. This is the giant whitefly. This was introduced in the 1990s into California, and its preferred host was hibiscus. And here are the adult flies. And you see all this white, these white hairs, that's wax. Wherever these white flies walk, they leave a trail of wax. And the nymphs are sedentary on the leaf and they produce long threads of wax off their backs. Take a look at this next picture. This also shows the giant white fly. And you can see that it looks like this leaf is growing a beard. There's lots of adults in here. If you shake this leaf when it's on the plant, all these little white flies will fly all over the place. So whitefly is not all that hard to diagnose or identify, but it is extremely difficult to control. They're extremely waxy, and a lot of the things we use to control these types of insects are not that effective on whitefly. So you have to spray repeatedly, and you have to get on them early. A lot of people stopped growing hibiscus because of the giant whitefly. Now, once the giant whitefly showed up, entomologists either at UC Riverside or Berkeley, and I don't recall which campus was heading this up, but the giant whitefly is native to Mexico. Go to Mexico, look for something that's parasitizing the giant whitefly in Mexico. When they went to Mexico, they couldn't find the giant whitefly for a while. It was in such a low population. You could find it anywhere in Los Angeles. It was on every hibiscus. It also went to xylosma, which is a shrub material. Went to avocado, it went to citrus. It had a wide host range, but of course, this dramatic infestation you saw in hibiscus was not typical, although it got pretty bad on the xylosma as well. So you go down to Mexico where you know it's from and you can't find it. Why? Because it's under natural biological control there. There's all sorts of things that eat it. So you got to find something that eats it and nothing else and bring it back and introduce it here. That's exactly what they did. They found a small parasitoid wasp, brought it back, released it, and now it's actually kind of hard to find giant whitefly. You still will find it occasionally on hibiscus, but it doesn't seem to occur on the other hosts really at all. So that is an example of a very successful biocontrol project. Not as successful as some others, but very successful. Now let's see if we have some more pictures of whitefly. Let's take a look at the next one. These are whitefly adults on the back of a leaf. Bring that up full screen. And you can see why they're called whiteflies. They are not true flies, though. They're not in the fly order Diptera. These are in Hemiptera. And now the next, this is a whitefly spiral. Take a look at our next picture. Now what happens is wherever an adult fly walks, it leaves a trail of wax. So somewhere in here, it started walking. And I think this is the trail. And you can see wherever it walked, it left this trail of wax behind. And here it probably flew away. So that's, you know, could be spiraling whitefly. There's a number of different whiteflies. There's the giant whitefly, spiraling whitefly. There are, like I said, nearly, I believe, 1,500 different species of whitefly. There's a crown whitefly you see on the backs of oak leaves. Sometimes you'll get this explosion of whiteflies. They'll all hatch out and be flying at the same time. The environment was just right for them. And suddenly the air is full of these little whiteflies. And a week later, they're all gone. Very typical of insects. Insects can explode in population and then disappear within weeks. So you think you've got this huge infestation problem, you're gonna do something about it. Whereas if you just wait a week or two, they'll all be gone on their own. Maybe back next year at the same time though. So now, the next group that we want to look at, let me see if I've got, I think I've got another video clip I want to go to. Let's go to our second video clip, which also talks about insects, and then after that we'll talk about some more aspects of insects in gardens.
Scale insects are plant parasites that live by staying very still on plants and inserting their long needle-like stylets into plant tissue. And they eat substances like phloem and other interior plant cells. And scale have a striking diversity of forms. Some cover themselves in wax while others will cover themselves in a cottony substance. And some just have very hard exoskeletons. And these adaptations are defenses for being as sedentary as scale are. Scale are probably the most sedentary of all of the insects. When scale eat phloem from plants, their poop is basically sugar water that's nicknamed honeydew, and a lot of other animals are happy to recycle this honeydew, most notably ants that often use scale as sugar water wells. And ants often have scale farms that they tend and protect. And sometimes queen ants, when they're leaving their nest to start a new colony, will carry a scale insect with them to start a new farm. Scale have many natural enemies that ants have to protect them from, including many species of beetles and parasitoid wasps. And parasitoid wasps are really interesting organisms that lay their eggs inside other organisms. And then their babies develop inside those other organisms. So for example, a parasitoid wasp will come up to a scale and lay its egg inside it. And then the eggs of the parasitoid wasp would develop inside of the scale insect and eventually hatch and eat the scale insect from the inside out, killing it. Parasitoids and other scale natural enemies are considered beneficial to farmers and landscapers because scales can often reach damaging population levels. And they're especially difficult for fruit growers because scale honeydew causes mold to develop on fruit. And most of the time, those scale live in small populations and act as just parts of ecosystems.
So that, you know, showed you a lot of pictures of different kinds of scale. That's why I kind of liked that video. And it also showed you cottony cushiony scale. Before I talk about cottony cushiony scale, because I want to talk about it briefly. That's an important scale, a pest of citrus. I want to show you some scale. I know we're jumping back a little bit because we talked about whiteflies, but now I'm talking about scale again. Let's take a look at these ivy leaves that came in. And you can see the scale on these ivy leaves. Let's go to the overhead. And now the thing about scale, I don't know if we can get a little closer. There's a couple things to notice. They tend to congregate at first right along the veins. So you can see that, you know, most of them right here are right along this vein. The eggs hatch and more of them start wandering around. And when they come out of the egg and they start walking around, that's called the crawler stage for scale. And that's when they're most vulnerable to sprays, especially oils and soaps. But you've got to hit them when they're crawling. After they crawl a little bit, they're going to settle down, start feeding, and then secrete a covering over themselves. And then it makes it very difficult to kill them without something that's more of a broad spectrum, more toxic material. So one way you can tell you got scale is you just take your fingernail and scrape it on there and it comes right off. I don't know if you can see that, but you can just scrape off the scale with your finger quite easily. It may have damaged the surface underneath. And you see this one is pretty heavily infested. And if you flip it over, you probably find some scale on the underside too. You see, you know, it doesn't really have a preference. It doesn't like to be out in the full sun, so on leaves that might be in the full sun, they'll probably be on the underside. But leaves that are growing in the shade, they'll be on both sides. So this is actually Algerian ivy. And I'm not sure which scale this is, but you can see, if you just take an individual scale right there, you can just scrape it off. And this is alive. These scale are still alive. There's nothing wrong with them at all. We had a few cold nights. That's not enough to kill them. And there are many, many different species of scale. Now, I mentioned cottony cushiony scale, and there was a picture of that in that last video clip. And I don't know that I got a picture of it in my pictures. I should. Cottony cushiony scale was introduced into California in the late 1800s, about 1890 or so, I believe from Australia. And it exploded on citrus. Now, it is almost strictly a citrus pest. It does feed on a couple other trees. And it almost wiped out citrus production in California. It was so bad. The plants were just covered with it. It was damaging them pretty severely. So, and I don't know who, a scientist from the University of California went to Australia, found the Vidalia beetle, which is a ladybug beetle, brought it back, introduced it into California, and within a year brought the cottony cushiony scale infestation under control. That is the first example of biocontrol, using one organism to control a damaging insect pest. So using one insect that feeds on it to control the pest. So that was the beginning of biocontrol. That was the very first biocontrol project in agriculture. And very, very successful. And today, that's how cottony cushiony scale is controlled in citrus orchards. It is controlled because of the Vidalia beetle. Now, they can spray and spray and spray, but that's awful expensive when you've got a little insect to do all the job for you. So let's go on and now talk about another group of insects called thrips. Thrips are in a different order, although they are also sucking insects. They are slender insects with fringed wings. Let's take a look at this first picture, number 18. These are thrips. They are often described as kind of shaped like an alligator. Of course, they have the six legs. That makes them an insect. But they are long and thin. And there's a lot of thrips. Some species of thrips feed on other insects or mites and are considered beneficial, while some feed on fungal spores or pollen. There are around 5,000 species of thrips described. They are metabolic insects with a distinctive cigar-shaped body plan, elongate with transversely constricted bodies. They have incomplete metamorphosis, which means they don't have a larval stage, that the young look just like the adults, they're just smaller. The rate at which thrips move through their development cycle is highly dependent on environmental conditions. That's generally true for most insects. So including the temperature and nutrient quality of their food will affect how quickly they develop. There are over 20 plant-infecting viruses that are known to be transmitted by thrips. And let's take a look at another thrip. This is the Myoporum thrips, this next picture. Now, Myoporum is a shrub that's native to Australia. There's the thrip. Now, I don't know if you can see it, but this is a leaf that's badly contorted. And this is just a little stem. What happened with Myoporum thrips is they cause the leaves to be galled and twisted and contorted, and they're inside those folds and very hard to control. And they cause the Myoporum to defoliate. And so when this was first introduced about 10, 15 years ago, it quickly spread throughout all the Myoporum, especially along the coast. It does really well along the coast. That's actually where most of the Myoporum was planted in the first place. I think it's a better coastal species than it is a hot inland valley species, because you don't see Myoporum a lot inland valley. And it causes the plants to defoliate, and after a few years, it actually killed the plants if you didn't control it. So we had a lot of calls on it. I went out several times to look at roadside plantings of Myoporum, where the Myoporum had been feeding on the shrubs for several years, if not even 4 or 5 years, and with no control. And those plants were dying, and many of them had already died. So generally speaking, these sucking insects don't kill plants. But if you let it go long enough, and if the infestation becomes severe enough, it will badly damage the plants and can possibly kill them. So those are Myoporum thrips. If you grow, now there's two Myoporum species that are really commonly grown. There's a prostrate Myoporum and there's a shrub Myoporum. And the thrips goes to either one equally well. But it's quickly decimating them in along the coast. Now this next picture is ficus thrips. Let's take a look at that and bring that up full screen. Now a lot of these thrips are very host specific. They don't feed on anything but one host. And this is true for this one. This is ficus thrips. And you can see the twisted and damaged leaves due to the feeding by the thrip. Now this is ficus microphylla, also called ficus nidida, very common street tree. This is about all it does to it. It just causes a little bit of damage. It's not going to kill the tree or really damage it very much. It just makes it look bad. But in order to control this, you pretty much have to use a systemic. This is an example of a sucking insect, but you still can't control it with just oils and soaps because it really covers everything up. Now there's another group of insects I want to talk about, and those are the sharpshooters. These are actually leafhoppers, and they're very important for a couple of reasons. This is the red-headed sharpshooter. Let's take a look at the next one. This is the green sharpshooter. These are native sharpshooters. And the next one is the blue-green sharpshooter. Actually, very pretty insects. They're kind of, bullet-shaped. Sharpshooters feed on the xylem. They don't feed on the phloem. And they don't get much nutrient from xylem. Xylem is mostly water, so they need a lot of it. Plus, they need to be able to suck that water out of the xylem vessels, which is already under negative pressure. So they've got to suck very hard. They need big old heads. Now let's take a look at the next one, the glassy-winged sharpshooter. And this has been introduced to California from Texas. It's native from Florida all the way to Texas. We know that the glassy-winged sharpshooters we have in California are from Texas. Let's take a look at the next picture. This is also the glassy-winged sharpshooter. And they usually have, if we go back, they usually have these white spots on the wings. But they have a big head. All the sharpshooters have fairly large heads. And this mottled appearance in here is very similar to the smoke tree sharpshooter, which I didn't show you a photo of. But let's come back, and I just want to explain why sharpshooters are so important. Sharpshooters, as I said, they're part of the leafhopper group. They acquire a bacteria called Xylella fastidiosa from infected plants. And then when they go feed on other plants, they move that bacteria to the healthy plant. So they are vectors for Xylella fastidiosa. What is so important about Xylella? Xylella causes bacterial leaf scorch, which is a fatal disease in those plants that are infected. Not all plants get it. That's always true. We don't get every fungus infecting us. There's always a suite of pathogens that infect a particular species. So the story of Xylella actually goes back to the 1890s when grapes started dying in the Anaheim area along the Santa Ana River. And it was called grape mystery disease or Anaheim disease. Newton Pierce worked on it, and it became known as Pierce's disease of grape. Newton Pierce was a plant pathologist working for the United States Department of Agriculture. He thought it was a virus at the time. People didn't understand viruses very well. There were no electron microscopes, and so viruses were just something so small you couldn't filter them, but they were infectious. And that's still true today. They are so small you really can't filter them out of plant sap, and you could infect plants with just plant sap in some cases. So for a long time, it was believed that it was a virus. During the 1940s, there were some attempts to control the disease on grape, which then became known as Pierce's disease of grape, with antibiotics, and they got remission. So there was evidence that antibiotics were affecting the disease, which means it's a bacterial disease, not a viral disease. In 1979, that's a long time to wait to diagnose a disease, nearly 100 years, Xylella was cultured out of infected plants, and they fulfilled what's called Koch's postulates, proving that this bacteria you could get out of the xylem was causing the disease. So then in 1990, glassy wing sharpshooter was discovered, and at the same time, oleanders started dying out in Riverside. And oleanders developed this disease called oleander leaf scorch, and it took a few years. It was diagnosed, the oleanders were diagnosed as being infected with Xylella fastidiosa. So they had the same disease that the grapes had called Pierce's disease of grape. But by that time, all the new hosts were being called scorch. When you got a new disease, you called it scorch, not Pierce's disease. So it was called oleander leaf scorch. Very soon after that, liquid amber started dying, then plums, now olives, and crepe myrtle. So you have oleander, crepe myrtle, olive, plum, and liquid amber. This was in the early 1990s, and now, especially on liquid amber, they're dying everywhere. And the glassy wing sharpshooter is everywhere. It's all over Southern California. It's very common. It'll feed on 200 different hosts. Now, of those 200 hosts, only 5 of them are susceptible to being infected by the bacteria. So that's why these sharpshooters are so important. Now, our native sharpshooters had been vectoring this disease into grape all along. They live mostly either in grasslands or they live along streams or drainage ditches. They don't particularly like landscapes. So you're not going to find our native sharpshooters in your backyard, on your citrus or feeding in your landscape, because they don't like landscapes. The glassy wing sharpshooter loves landscapes. You will find them all the way from Ventura to San Diego County. You can probably find them in almost anyone's garden unless they're spraying and controlling them. And they're not the easiest to control because they're fairly mobile and they move around a lot. But they tend to not like dry plants because they're feeding on the xylem. The xylem is under negative pressure. They have to suck on it really hard to get it out, even when the plant's well hydrated. So when plants go dry, they will abandon the plant and go look for a well-watered plant. So typically our native sharpshooters that lived along streams would be fine there, and they wouldn't leave until the stream started to drop down in the summer, because that's what streams do. During the spring, they're real full. All the plants are hydrated. And as we get into the summer, the streams start getting lower, the plants start going under drought stress, and then the sharpshooters would start flying out of there looking for something that is well watered. What's right next to the stream? A grape orchard, or vineyard, I should say. So they would come out during the summer months, get into the vineyard, and feed on the grapes. And they would move the bacteria that they acquired along the stream, because this bacteria normally occurs, or naturally occurs, in grasses and riparian plants that grow along streams, not really causing disease. Those are kind of inoculum reservoirs. They may cause a little bit of disease. It doesn't kill the plants. They tolerate the infection. But when you put it into grape, it kills them. And there's no treatment once you get it into the plant. So for years, they always had what they called the edge effect. Right along the edge of the vineyard, you'd get one, two, or three rows would get infected with Pierce's disease. But it wouldn't get deep into the vineyard because those sharpshooters wouldn't go deep into the vineyard. They would only go in the first two or three rows. And they were getting in there because those grapes were irrigated and the riparian area was starting to go under drought stress. And they did a similar experiment in citrus where they released glassy wing sharpshooter into different blocks of citrus that were watered four ways at 60% of ET, 80% of ET, 100% of ET, and 120% of ET. Now, ET is your ET rate. So 100% of ET is fully watered, 120% is extra water, 80% is deficit irrigation, and 60% is going to be drought stressing the plants. So they painted the four types, they used four different colors and coated the sharpshooters, released them in the four blocks. Within a week, all the sharpshooters released in the 60 and 80% blocks had left and gone into the 100 and 120% blocks because it's too hard for them to feed on dry plants or drought-stressed plants. So that really speaks to their biology. And that kind of illustrates that they're going to leave the riparian areas and go into the vineyards, and that's for our natives. Well, we've reached the top of the hour. We'll always like to stop here with a little station identification to remind you we're broadcasting from Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. It's a beautiful campus and a wonderful school. So let's take a look at this video clip or this station identification. And when we come back, we'll talk more about insects and the various problems insects cause in our gardens.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Stand. this is where STEM comes alive.
The reason I chose to attend Cal State Dominguez was because of its close proximity to my home, also because I have a lot of family members who have graduated from Cal State Dominguez as well.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
To DHTV on Tuesday night for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
I chose CSU Dominguez Hills because most of my friends from high school were attending other universities within the area. I wanted to branch off and establish my own network. And that's exactly what I found here at Dominguez Hills, a great network.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
My name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mack. education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Come to Dominguez Hill is because I'm passionate about sociology and they have a great program here.
DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney and I'm your host and instructor. This is the garden show where we talk about everything about plants, plant materials, how to water, how to fertilize, how to prune, what you can grow and where you can grow it. We talk about trees, we talk about turf, apples, zinnias, whatever you want to talk about. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. And if you have a question about your garden, we'll talk about your problem, or you know, if you had great success, call up and tell us how you had great success in your garden. Now, we've talked about a variety of insects. We're going to move on to we're going to now talk about the largest group of insects there is, and those are the beetles, and they belong in the order Coleoptera. So beetles are huge. They are incredibly important. Contains more described species, we're talking about Coleoptera, than in any other order in the animal kingdom, consisting about 25% of all known life forms. 40% of all described insect species are beetles, about 350,000 species, and I believe it's more than that actually at this point in time. I think it's closer to 500,000 known described species of beetles. They often feed on plants and fungi, break down animal and plant debris, and eat other invertebrates. Certain species are agricultural pests, such as the Colorado potato boll and the boll weevil. Let's take a look at this first one. This is a striped cucumber beetle. And the striped cucumber beetle actually does quite a bit of damage. It will rasp away at a leaf and they do a lot of damage in vegetable production. So this is one you should be able to recognize. Other species of beetles are important controls of agricultural pests. For example, beetles in the family, the ladybug beetle family, consume aphids, scale insects, and thrips. Like all insects, beetles' bodies are divided into three sections, the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. Beetles are generally characterized by a particularly hard ectoskeleton and hard forewings. Beetles have mouth parts similar to those of grasshoppers. Beetles are chewing insects. They are not sucking insects. They have what we call mandibles rather than a stylet. Mandibles are a pair of hard, often tooth-like structures that move horizontally to grasp, crush, or cut food or enemies. So let's take a look at a few of them. This next one is the tin-lined June beetle. This is an interesting beetle. The larvae feed on the roots of pine trees, and when the beetle comes up, it will feed on needles. Now, usually there's so few of them, they don't do much damage. This next one is the green fruit beetle, and it has an interesting story because this will start flying in June, maybe even May, And they are very slow flyers, and they make a low kind of a sound when they're flying around. And they will feed on fruit, but they usually don't do much damage because there's usually not very many of them. And they rasp at the fruit. So they'll feed on peaches, soft fruit typically. I've never seen them damage citrus. But they will feed on things like peaches and other stone fruits. The grubs are enormous. They are probably about 2 or 3 inches long, big white grubs. And you will find them in mulch piles or directly in the soil. And so they're very common when you have a big mulch pile in your backyard, like I do, and I see them every year. They have an extremely shiny metallic underbody right there. You can just see that turquoise metallic color. Of course, the four wings and this whole area is kind of a dull green, but they have a very shiny underside, and it looks metallic. A lot of people will find this and think they found the Japanese beetle, which is very damaging to agriculture and to plants, has a wide host range, feeds on a lot of stuff. Japanese beetle does not occur in California. It is introduced on the eastern United States and has really made it all the way up to the Continental Divide. But it's not going to get over the Continental Divide on its own. It's going to have to be transported into the western United States. And they do find them occasionally in planes, and most planes are checked for them after they land. They fly into the cargo holds. And then when they get here, you open the cargo hold and they fly out. But there is no established population of Japanese beetle in California. This next one is the spotted cucumber beetle. This is another one that's pretty destructive in vegetable gardens. And this next one is the Altissia flea beetle. And so the Altissia flea beetle also rasps at the foliage and is very destructive. If we can bring up number 30. Let's see, there it is. So you can see where it's fed on the leaf and kind of is just starting to skeletonize it. Let's take a look at the next one, the elm leaf beetle. Everyone can kind of recognize a beetle, not necessarily knowing exactly the species. This next one is called the alder leaf beetle. This is number 32. And this is also skeletonizing the leaf, and it's probably the larva. Here's the larva. These aren't the adults. They're going to pupate and come out as adult beetles at some point. But you can see what it's doing to the leaf. It's skeletonizing the leaf, and so it rasps away. It leaves behind the veins, which are a little woodier and doesn't like to eat, and it's eating the stuff between the veins. And this next one is the Diaprepes root weevil, which is particularly important beetle species. And so this one is also called the Caribbean or the citrus root weevil. Diaprepes is the genus. And what happens with this is it will eat on the edges of the leaves and scallop the edges of the leaves. And then it lays its eggs on the leaves. And when they hatch out as a larva, they fall off the leaf and land on the ground and burrow into the soil and feed on the roots of citrus and other hosts. It has a wide host range. It'll go to a lot of palms and a variety of trees. Then they'll feed on the roots for about a year or so, and then they pupate and come out of the ground. So you'll find these little tiny holes in the soil, and then they'll walk up the trunk and start feeding on the foliage. So the adults feed on the foliage and the larvae feed on the roots. It's particularly damaging to citrus. It was introduced into California probably 4 or 5 years ago, maybe longer. And it's established in a number of areas in California, and it's gotten onto a lot of lemon trees down in San Diego County and Orange County. And some of the some of the orange groves or lemon groves where it is established, after it's been feeding on the roots for a while, you can just walk up and push the tree over. It's so damaged to the root system. There was an interior state quarantine on this for a while, but then they gave up on it. Let's take a look at the larva form. This next one is the larva for the Diaprepes root weevil. Now, a lot of larvae are very similar. They're white, grubs. You'll find this in the soil. When it pupates, here's the pupal stage for the Diaprepes root weevil. Let's take a look at the next picture. And this is the pupal stage, and you'll find these just at the surface of the soil right before they emerge as adult beetles and start walking up the trunk to feed on the foliage. So Now let's just talk a little bit before we move on to some of the other, I've got some other beetles and stuff. I want to talk briefly about pine bark beetles. Pine bark beetles are wood boring beetles. And so you got all these beetles, you got really hundreds of thousands of different species of beetles. A lot of the beetles are wood boring insects. And so wood boring beetles that attack living trees are really a tremendous problem. Once they get into the tree, you're toast. You cannot control something that gets into the trunk. Once it gets in there, very few cases where there's a beetle that the larval, you know, the adult burrows into the trunk, lays eggs, the eggs hatch, they start feeding either directly on the wood or they'll feed on a fungus that the beetle introduces to the tree and it causes a canker. So those are called ambrosia beetles that feed on fungi that they introduce into the tree. It's been said by some people that every one of these bark beetles, every one of these wood-boring beetles carries some type of fungus with it that the larvae feed on. I don't know that's true for all of them. I think there's some pretty obvious examples that that's not the case. But we'll talk about some of those beetles in a minute. But I want to talk a little bit about the pine bark beetles. We've got a lot of native pines in California. We've got the Jeffrey pine, ponderosa pine, and many others, Coulter pine, all sorts of pines that are native to the Sierra Mountains and the coastal mountain ranges and the San Gabriel Mountains, the Santa Monica Mountains, the San Bernardino Mountains. We've got all these mountain ranges and we've got all our native pines. During times of severe drought, the trees become extremely drought stressed. That's when they are attacked by these various pine bark beetles and the various genera, Ips, Dendrocnus. There's a bunch of different types of pine bark beetles. They tend to be fairly host specific. They attack either one or two species of pines, but they always attack when the tree is drought stressed or damaged from some other cause. So our last, I don't know, we're being told the drought isn't over and the drought's not over, except in a sense that once we get good rains and these trees get enough water, they're not drought stressed anymore. So as far as the forest is concerned, if we get one good winter, then they're not so much drought stressed anymore. And the problem is that you go through 4 or 5 years of drought and the population of the bark beetles becomes enormous. They will even attack healthy, non-drought stressed trees. Now, we've had a lot of droughts over the last 20 years, long droughts. And we've had some tremendous pine tree mortality rates up in the forest. So in some areas, like if you drive up to Lake Arrowhead, on the road up there, you'll go through areas of the forest where 100% of the pines have died because of pine bark beetle and drought. This is not something that's only occurring here in California. It's occurring all over the western United States. There's no way to deal with it. Two things kind of exasperate it. One is that we don't let the forest fires just rage and burn the whole forest down. We go in and we try and stop the fire. If we were allowed a fairly frequent or fires to go through and burn out the dead trees, it would dramatically reduce the population of the bark beetles. The healthy trees hopefully wouldn't be killed by the fire. But if we put off fire for many, many, many years, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, when the fires come through, they're much hotter and they kill everything. The real solution to bark beetle would be a massive fire that burns down all the dead trees, but that's not going to happen. Well, it may happen beyond whether we like it or not, actually. But generally speaking, we put out those fires, we fight those fires, but they get harder to fight when we have more dead trees. When we have a forest of all dead trees, how do you stop it? It's just going to rage through that area. So how do you protect pines in your own garden? Is you deep water them once a month during the spring and into the summer a little bit, depending on the pine you're growing. So if you water your pine once a month, but you've got to give it a deep soak, you got to water it for a few hours, even if you're just slowly dribbling the water on or have a drip system, you may need to water it for 6 hours or 12 hours or even 24 hours. I see we have a phone call. Let's go to our caller. Terry from Pasadena, you're on the air.
Yeah, I have a question about wanting to know about where to get these wasps that attack Asian citrus psyllid. I want to let them go in my yard because I'm worried about my orange tree. I want to know, will it get citrus greening, which is fatal if I don't do something like get this wasp?
Okay, well, let's first talk about the wasp. There's actually two different wasps that have been released. There's a professor out at UC Riverside, Professor Hoddle, and he works on invasive introduced exotic species. And he went back to Pakistan and found two different wasps. These are teeny little tiny wasps. You can barely see them. And he has released those in Southern California. And many times people call us up and they've heard about biocontrol projects using these small wasps. And they want to know, where can I get one? Where can, you know, occasionally they are available, depending on the species, from an insectuary. In this case, you can't buy them. They're not available to you. And that's not how it's going to work. What happens is the wasps are brought back to California. They're held in quarantine for either a year or two while it's proved that they won't feed on any other insects. Then they're released. So Don Hoddle, or Hodel, has released the wasps in several locations and is now recovering them miles from the areas he released them. So they're going to end up in your yard naturally. You don't need to go buy them and release them. And all it's really going to do is help us suppress the population of Asian citrus psyllid. Psyllids are small insects. They have wings. There's many different species of psyllids. They're usually very host specific. The Asian citrus psyllid feeds on citrus and some other citrus related plants that are in the Rutaceae, which is the, I guess that's the myrtle family. And so you can't get them, but they're going to be in your yard anyway. So that's the good news. You don't need to get them because they're already coming. The bad news is citrus greening is here in California. We've had one tree about 4 years ago found infected in Hacienda Heights. We had four trees in San Gabriel found a few months ago. I just heard in the last week another tree was found infected in the same vicinity as the original four trees. So we're going to hear more and more about more trees infected with citrus greening in California. That's really unfortunate because it is a fatal disease of citrus that you cannot control. Once a tree is infected, it will die. The psyllid is now widespread throughout Southern California. It has actually been discovered also up in the Central Valley in a couple locations, like in Bakersfield. It will slowly spread out through the rest of the state where citrus is grown. And so in order to protect your tree, what I would do is when you have new growth in the spring, I would spray it with soaps and oils once a week or so. That will greatly control any sucking insects in the tree. Psyllids are sucking insects. They shouldn't be too hard to control with soaps and oils. If that doesn't, if that's not effective, you should use an oil with a pyrethrin. We'll talk about that more next week when we talk about integrated pest management and the various tools you have to control insect pests. So people have called to get the various wasps that are introduced for the ash whitefly or for the giant whitefly. But these wasps are not normally available to people to purchase because they're being released as a program by a professor at a university, and then they become established in the environment. You don't need to buy them.
Okay. Now I understand what to do. Well, thank you for your help. I really enjoy your show.
Okay. Thanks you very much, and thank you for calling.
Bye-bye.
So that's a good point. You know, I did want to mention that another tree has been found infected with citrus greening in the San Gabriel area, and it did not expand the quarantine area for citrus greening or HLB, Huanglongbing disease of citrus. The Asian citrus psyllid is the vector. It acquires the bacteria that causes the disease from an infected tree and then transmits it to healthy trees. The psyllid is now widespread throughout Southern California. How do you protect your citrus? Well, you can try and keep those psyllids off your tree as much as possible. And where do they like to lay their eggs, and where do the larvae like to feed? On the new tender growth. In fact, if we have time, we'll get to a video that shows how to find that. But so that's the situation for citrus greening. We did, the state, California Department of Food and Ag, has found another infected tree, but it was very close to the trees that were already found infected a few months ago. And now, so that the quarantine area for the disease did not get any bigger. Now, all of Los Angeles County, I think all of, you know, it's Los Angeles County, Riverside County, Orange County, San Diego County, Imperial County, Ventura County, that's the quarantine area for the psyllid, but the quarantine area for the disease is smaller. But if we find more infected trees outside, it will get bigger. Now, I have a video that talks about bark beetles in the Colorado mountains. So let's go to Colorado forests and the pine bark beetle epidemic. I want to show you what's happening to our pine forests across the western United States due to pine bark beetles. The only thing that's going to cure this is rain. Unfortunately, our climate is changing. If you don't believe in global warming is dramatically affecting the western United States already. And part of it is we're not getting enough rain to sustain our pine forests, and they are being attacked by pine bark beetles. So let's take a look at this, and you'll see how serious the pine bark beetle problem is and how serious global warming really is.
The mountain pine beetle has been attacking forests for millions of years. This cycle is different. This one is unprecedented, both in its intensity at a site and also in its geographic extent. This thing goes from New Mexico, 1,000 miles north to the Yukon Territories, from the Front Range of Colorado to the Pacific Ocean. This thing is already 10 times bigger than the second biggest epidemic in history. And people are wondering, why is this one so big?
Coloradans want to know what the next forest will look like over the next 100 years. What will this turn into?
Scientists at the University of Colorado are working to find answers to these questions. Jeff Mitten and Scott Fehrenberg are trapping pine beetles and documenting attacks on trees just east of the Continental Divide. They are finding that longer, warmer growing seasons and persistent drought make the trees more vulnerable to pine beetles. Trees are killed as female beetles bore through the bark to lay their eggs.
Scott, look. A bark beetle is just starting a new hole now. I can see, I just saw the bark beetle go into that hole.
Yeah, I can see him too. There's another one here, Jeff.
When beetles attack a tree, it's a green tree. When they mass attack it, within a few days, water is no longer moving up, carbohydrates are no longer coming down. It's effectively dead, but it looks perfectly healthy for another 10 months to 12 months. The following summer in July, it begins to turn red like some of the trees around us. The tree needs water for everything, but one of the primary uses of the water, and certainly the primary defense, is that the water is turned into resin. And the resin is stored in resin canals in the bark, and that is what the bark beetle severs when it goes tunneling into the tree.
Here we go, Jeff, look at these. Darkened up, ready to fly.
If the tree is beautifully healthy, an enormous flow of resin will actually push it out. Foresters say it's being pitched out. It's pitch tossing the beetle out. That's the defense of the tree. Some people have asked, how many bark beetles does it take to kill a tree? And the answer is, it's incredibly variable. If a tree is healthy and it's got all the water that it needs, there are documented cases where 2,000 beetles will hit a tree, all of them get pitched out, and the tree survives the entire attack. If it doesn't have enough water, the resin pressure goes down. It can only put out a little bit of resin. The beetle has no problem with that, and the beetle calls in more and more, and they collectively sense we've won, and that tree is a goner. Does drought or climate change have something to do with it? It certainly does.
Jeff and Scott have compared their observations of beetle activity in May and June with records from the University of Colorado's Mountain Research Station, where climatologists have been closely tracking daily temperatures for decades.
It gets warmer and drier during the summers now. The temperature is particularly changing in spring, before July 1. And so if it's hotter and drier, this is a more susceptible tree. So then instead of perhaps 800 beetles needed to kill this tree, perhaps only 200 are needed to kill it. If it gets really drought stressed, a couple dozen can kill it. All right, let's see how it goes. In addition, one of the consequences of the change in summer temperature is the bark beetle life cycle has really changed. 2, 3, and 4 decades ago, the bark beetles started coming out in July. There was a pulse of them the second and the third week in August. 1, 2, and their offspring would get out of the tree the following year at about the same time. A female bark beetle can lay about 60 eggs. What Scott and I have found is that the bark beetles now are starting much, much earlier. This year, when did you catch the first beetles?
May 22nd.
May 22nd, instead of the first few coming out in July. And that's fully 2 months earlier. Furthermore, we catch them later. We catch them as late as September 20th. So the season is fully twice as long as it used to be. And we saw last year that the ones that can start early, their offspring are out in August, not 12 months later, 2 months later. As a consequence, a female that can start in June has 60 offspring, and then her offspring each have about 60. So that's 60 offspring plus 3,600 in a year. And so the season is much longer. The beetles are now starting in May instead of in July. So the reproductive potential is exponentially greater than it's been before, because at least some of the beetles are pulling off 2 generations per year. We think this is one of the reasons that this epidemic is unprecedented in scale and intensity. Within about 5 years, almost every large lodgepole in the state will be killed.
The mountain pine beetle has affected more than 3 million acres of forest in Colorado.
So that's a little depressing. I got to tell you, when you look at the widespread devastation from pine bark beetles across the western United States into Canada as well and Mexico, it's a little depressing, because if those forests are decimated, and they are getting decimated, millions of trees have died already. What happens to all the animals that live in that forest? What happened to the deer? What happens to the squirrels? What happens to, you know, all the birds? It's an ecosystem, and it's being destroyed. Let's we have an email question, and we've got some photographs of a coast redwood from Silver Lake, from Hugh Kinney. Let's take a look at the picture. Can we bring up this picture? Bring it up full screen. Let's see if it's browned out. First off, I'm not sure that's even a redwood. Gotta tell you that I've had a hard time recognizing it, and that doesn't look like a redwood bark either. So these are exit holes from a bark beetle. All these are exit holes, which is not a good sign, which means that this tree was attacked by a wood-boring beetle. Let's go back to the original picture, and I can talk to you a little bit about redwoods. The tree does, if it's brown, you know, the way you check a tree, first off, it'll be brown. But you go up and you start bending the small stems and twigs. And if they're dry and brittle and snap, they're dead. If you can't find any green wood on the tree, you know, if everything is dry and brittle and just snaps, then that really looks like a pine more than it looks like a redwood. But anyway, it's hard, you know, just, and its growth form doesn't look like a redwood either, by the way. So, but maybe it is a redwood, and I just can't tell from the photograph without a close-up of the foliage itself. But what's happening to redwoods in Southern California, now that does look like a redwood. Sorry, at first it didn't look like a redwood, but now the trunk looks a little more like a redwood. But you can see that there's something burrowing into it. Now, in general, redwoods don't get bark wood-boring insects very much at all. They are very resistant to insects, the wood itself. But they are very sensitive to salt. And so what happens to redwood trees, typically, is that if we get a regular winter where we get a little bit of rain, you know, 15 inches, 20 inches of rain, downtown LA gets 15 inches, Pasadena gets 23 inches annually. The top of Mount Wilson gets 50 inches of precipitation every year. So if you get our normal winter and we get some rain, what it does is it leaches salts below the root zone for things like redwood trees, avocado trees. These, both of those are very sensitive to salt. Our water that we water and irrigate our landscapes with is Colorado River water for the most part. It is hard water. And so the way you measure that is what they call dissolved solids in the water. And typically your tap water in Southern California will be about 400 or up to 500 parts per million of dissolved solids. Those are calcium salts and magnesium salts. And that is very hard on redwood trees and on avocado trees and another tree, the Japanese maple, Acer palmatum. They are salt sensitive species. And so in the spring, if you had a good winter, all the new growth will look fine. On your redwood tree, you'll get nice new needles growing, and it's green and it's lush and it looks wonderful. As you get into the summer months and we're watering with our Colorado River water, you start to get browning of the needles in the middle of the summer. And by the end of the summer, into the fall, you'll get a little browning on the canopy. As long as we get good rains the following winter, it will leach the salts below the root zone and you'll get good growth again the next spring. But when we don't get rain in the winter, the salts accumulate in the soil and the salt burn gets worse and worse and worse. So judging from that tree, I doubt if it's even irrigated. And if you don't irrigate redwoods, they're just not going to make it. They are not native to Southern California. Even though we talk about native California trees, they're not native to Southern California. They're native to Northern California, where they get lots of rain. The coastal redwood, of course, grows right on the border, up there at Eureka and on the border with Oregon. And they get lots of fog and lots of rain, and it's cool and it never gets hot, and that's where they grow. So we grow them down here in Southern California. They don't like our hard water. They don't like long, hot summers. So they're not a particularly good species to grow in Southern California, but they're grown widely. So now when I'm driving around, I see dead ones everywhere. They are dying left and right. It's not a disease. It is mostly drought and salt burn. And if that tree is dead, yes, it needs to be cut down. Should you grow another redwood there? My answer is no. It's not a good species for Southern California. You might be able to get away with them a little better right along the coast, although the salt problem might be even worse. So generally speaking, I don't recommend that people grow redwoods. They're marginal tree species for Southern California. It's not a good fit for our climate. You're much better off with our native, some of our other native species, California coast live oak or some of the other oaks that are native to California, the Engelmann oak, the valley oak, the blue oak. There's a lot of nice oaks that do well in Southern California. We do have some pests that are big problems on them right now, so we'll have to talk about that later. But that tree, if it's, like I said, if the twigs and everything is dry and brittle, it's a dead, it's gone. You just bend them, and if they snap and break and they're dry and you can't find anything that's flexible, and if you scrape it a little, you should find a little green layer right under the bark. That's the vascular cambium. If you can't find any green layers anywhere under the bark, then the tree has died. And if it is a redwood, then I'm not surprised at all, because it's not getting irrigated right there. There's no irrigation for it, And I've seen this problem in drought years for a long time. I was called to the Griffith Park by an old friend of mine who worked for the Los Angeles Recreation and Parks Department. And her responsibility was for maintaining the trees in Griffith Park and a lot of the parks. She was one of the upper administrators in that department, and it had been a long drought. This was years ago. After nearly a six-year drought, and they water the Griffith Park with that recycled water from the Hyperion sewage treatment facility, and that water that's purified from sewage It's very, very hard water. It's got a lot of stuff in it. It's not sewage anymore. It's stuff that it just accumulates from treating it. And they use that to irrigate Griffith Park. Well, if we get good rain in the winter, it's not so bad. But if you're irrigating it with that kind of water year-round with no rain, then the salts build up in the soil. And they were losing redwood trees all over the place in Griffith Park because of that extended drought and the hard water from that sewage treatment facility. So it's nothing new. It's just much worse than I've ever seen it before. Redwood trees, I see them dying pretty much everywhere, especially if they were in lawns and people stopped watering the lawn to save water and they didn't make an arrangement to keep watering the tree. So no one is trying to tell people not to water their trees. If you want to save water by not watering your lawn, then get a soaker hose that you can wrap around the base of the tree and turn it on once a month in the spring and the fall, and maybe every 2 weeks in the hottest part of the summer, August, September. But that looks like a street tree with very, very limited access for irrigation. And so it really was dependent on winter rains in order to keep it alive, and we just haven't had them. So that's probably the main reason it died. So if there's a close-up of that tree where you could show me the foliage, then I could confirm it's a redwood, although I guess on the second look at that bark, it did look like redwood bark. Let's go on to our another very, very important invasive pest and go to our next picture, which is 36. This is called the gold-spotted oak borer, and this is actually one of the things that's attacking California coast live oak, our native oak. And you can see that the gold-spotted oak borer, which is a beetle, has these six gold spots on its wings. And they're not very big. You know, this is just a penny, so they're just little tiny insects. And let's take a look at our next picture, which shows their exit holes. They have a unique exit hole, which is kind of D-shaped. You see this one right here? They have a flat side and a round side, so they're D-shaped. And you can see that one there, and this one here is really typical. That one's a little rounder. This one here clearly shows that flat side with the round side. And that's what you'll see when you see these gold-spotted oak borers leaving the tree. Now, originally these gold-spotted oak borers were being found in the Cleveland National Forest, down along Ortega Highway, by San Juan Capistrano. And it's killed a lot of oaks in that Cleveland National Forest. Let's look at our next picture, which shows you the mortality rate in this canyon in the Cleveland National Forest. All these gray trees are dead oaks. And this is chaparral stuff on the sides that's not being affected. This looks like nearly 100% mortality of oaks in this canyon. So this has been a devastating infestation, and how did it get here? Well, it's believed that this beetle is actually native to Arizona and was brought to California in firewood. Firewood is a great way to move exotic invasive wood-boring pests or beetles. And so very soon after it was found in the Cleveland National Forest, within a few years, it was discovered in Idlewild, and that's nearly 50 to 75 miles from there. So the beetle couldn't have flown that far. So somebody packed up some firewood and then went up to go camping up in Idlewild and brought the firewood with them. And the beetles came out of the firewood and started attacking oaks up in the Idlewild area. The latest new infestation of the gold-spotted oak borer is in up in Antelope Valley. It's in, I guess it's Green Valley. I always get this flipped in my head, Green Valley or Grass Valley. I think it's Green Valley. It's up in the mountains above the valley where they found oaks infested with gold-spotted oak borer. So how did it go from Cleveland National Forest all the way north of the mountain range up into the Antelope Valley? Somebody moved firewood. That's how it got there. There's no doubt about it. So there's a big effort to try and convince the public not to move firewood. Buy it where you burn it, or burn it where you buy it, however you want to look at that phrase. You shouldn't pack up firewood from Southern California and drive it up to the Sierras, or drive it all over the place, because it's very likely to have one of these wood-boring beetles and you may be moving that beetle hundreds of miles, whereas it would never move that far on its own. At least it wouldn't do it for a long time, decades and decades in order to move a beetle from Southern California. In fact, it might never, ever make it to the Sierras. It's just too far for it to fly. So now I got put on a committee, the Gold Spotted Oak Borer Committee for Los Angeles County, to try and figure out how we're going to go up and try and eradicate that new infestation up in Antelope Valley. So we all got together. There were members of the committee from the Los Angeles County Fire Department, from Los Angeles County County Council, all the lawyers who work for LA County, people from my department, the Ag Commissioner's Department. So we had all these people on this committee. We're trying to find the funds and how we can get up there and cut down those trees rapidly and prevent this infestation from growing further. That's a great effort. It's laudable that people want to try and do this. The reality is that we've never eradicated an insect pest that was introduced ever before. It's probably not going to happen now. And it's just, you've got to jump on this kind of stuff almost yesterday. You can't wait 6 months, because in the spring, in another 4 weeks, the trees that are infested up there, those beetles are going to start coming out and flying around and attacking other trees that don't have the beetle in them. So you've got to get up there and cut down these infected trees, and you've got to do it fast. Well, that's, committees don't work fast. If you've ever been on a committee, that's the epitome of slow. The slowest thing in the world is to work with a committee. If you want to do something fast, you get one person, give them the money, and say, get this done now. Then you could get it done quickly. Committees just don't work that way. So that's a real serious problem. The other thing that's attacking coast live oaks and a lot of natives is the polyphagous shothole borer. I don't have any pictures of shothole borer. They're tiny, tiny little insects, a little tiny beetle, about maybe less than a half an inch, maybe about a quarter inch long. They are attacking 37 different tree species, including California coast live oak, although that's not a preferred host, but the western sycamore, Platanus racemosa, are native California sycamore or western sycamore, depending on what common name you want to use for it, is a prime host for shothole borer. And they are being attacked, all of them are being attacked virtually throughout the San Gabriel Valley, which is the center of the shothole borer infestation. But it has now been reported all the way from Laverne out to the San Fernando Valley, all the way down to Long Beach. So the shothole borer is really spread all over the place, and it's attacking 37 different species of trees in the urban forest. All the maples are prime hosts. Avocado is an excellent host. Mimosa is a good host. Western sycamore is a host. Mimosa is a host. So there's all these trees that are hosts, and one of the best hosts is actually castor bean, which is an invasive weed you find in almost any vacant lot in Southern California, and a lot of them are full of the beetle. So that's a real problem. Now, so I just wanted to cover some of those wood-boring insects. And I probably have just enough time to go to our... we're going to skip the beetles are coming, pine beetles destroy British Columbia forest, because I think we've covered that enough. We don't have time for it. But I would like to show detecting Asian citrus psyllid from the University of California Agricultural Natural Resources. This is our fifth video, but we're skipping number four. Can we go to the fifth video real quick to show people what the Asian citrus psyllid looks like? Let's go to that video before we run out of time.
The adult stages of the psyllid can live anywhere on the tree, but the immature stages, the eggs and the little tiny nymphs, have to live on brand new flesh like this. So they would be tucked down in around these tiny, tiny leaves. So that's where we want you to look for Asian citrus psyllid most commonly. You will see damaged leaves, especially on this new kind of foliage, and you'll see sometimes sooty mold, the sticky stuff that aphids and psyllids produce, and you'll see small orangish yellow nymphs and those little white tubules that they produce on their bodies. It's pretty easy to distinguish from an aphid if you know insects fairly well, because the adults will tilt their rear ends up in the air, and aphids don't do that. And the nymphs produce little waxy tubules around their rear ends. So with a hand lens, I can see really quickly that that's a psyllid nymph and not an aphid.
So I just wanted to show you what that Asian citrus psyllid looked like. So if you're growing citrus, if you've got orange trees or lemon trees, lime trees, tangerines, whatever you're growing, you want to closely examine your tree at least once a week and maybe twice a week in March. As we're going to get our new flush of growth from your citrus in the next few weeks. And we're going to get hot next week, and so that might, you know, it might come on a little earlier than normal if we would stay cold. So look at your trees. Look at that tender new growth and look for the Asian citrus psyllid. If you find it, I strongly recommend you control it. Now, you can spray with oils and pyrethrins, and that should knock it down. But you need to repeat the spray fairly frequently, at least for a few weeks. So you would spray at least once a week for 3 weeks. And in general, you want to do that every spring with your citrus because you're going to get aphids, you're going to get mealybug, you're going to get whitefly, and you might get ACP, Asian citrus psyllid. So typically, to keep your citrus clean, starting about the 1st of March or the last week of February, depending on how aggressive you want to be, you can start spraying your tree with either soap or oil or a pyrethrin. All of that is organic treatment. So organic doesn't mean no pesticides, it means organic pesticides. And sometimes the rules are silly and you won't be organic because you use something they don't think is organic anymore, like cottonseed meal. Can you believe that cottonseed meal is no longer considered organic because it comes from genetically modified cotton plants? Cottonseed meal is the best fertilizer you can use in your garden for a variety of reasons. So it's good for your plants. It's one of the best ways to fertilize. And I don't care that it comes from a genetically modified plant. It doesn't really matter. That's not going to affect the quality of the cottonseed meal. Now, before we move on, I got just a minute left. Let's go to the 43, which shows the citrus leaf miner. The citrus leaf miner is a small moth, and move on to the next picture, which shows the damage to citrus leaves. And you can see this tunneling in the leaf. This is the larva from the moth, and it eats inside the leaf and causes the leaf to be twisted and curled. Come on back to me. And let's go to the overhead real quick. I know we only have a minute left. And I'll show you on this overhead before I run out of time. Some of the damage. You can see the damage here to the leaf on this kumquat. And it leaves this kind of shiny appearance, but it's really a line that's serpentine or snake-like in the leaf. You see, these leaves are clean and these are infested, so you will get no infestation in the spring. You get it starting in about mid-June. And we'll talk about how to control that next week when we talk about integrated pest management. But we're running out of time. It's been a great show. I want to encourage everyone to watch next week when we talk about integrated pest management. We're going to take the information about beetles and all the bugs we talked about today. Then we're going to talk about how you control them and how you don't control, get rid of the good guys. I want to thank everybody for coming in on Sunday and helping to put on the show in the control room. We'll see you next week when we talk about IPM. Until then, happy gardening.